dry eye itself is on the increase, and the incidence and prevalence of glaucoma is on the increase, and we've increasing number of drops to treat glaucoma. But we as glaucoma specialists are more concerned with the optic disc and treating the glaucoma part. So regarding dry eye, we are not that much concerned. So are we silent to this menace? To Dr. Sagar Barve is going to bring more clarity to this topic.
Good morning, everybody. At the outset, let me thank Arijit to kind of make me part of this course. Thanks, Arijit. So to answer your question, I was indeed silent to this menace about three, four years back, till I saw this. This is a patient of mine who was on anti-glaucoma medication, underwent a cataract surgery, and end up with a picture like this about 6 weeks post-cataract surgery. This really opened my eyes. So what was exactly happening here? You see, ultimately the patient recovered in a period of next 4 weeks, but when we started digging into the case, what went wrong? Why this patient actually developed this kind of a presentation? So what we saw was, we actually missed dry eye due to meibomitis in this patient. To start with, this patient was already on anti-glaucoma medication. On the top of it, he had an array of post-cataract medication, which included steroids and non-steroidal anti-inflammatory. So essentially, a combination of these three actually caused the ocular surface breakdown. So this really opened my eyes for this particular condition. So when you talk about glaucoma, goals of glaucoma treatment, it's essentially, we all know, it's to maintain patient's visual function, as well as to maintain quality of life. And when you have, you know, dry eye which sets in a patient, the quality of life is definitely going to go down, and this will ultimately lead to poor compliance and ultimately glaucoma progression. So is there any relationship between glaucoma and dry eye? Well, there are close to 800 odd articles that have been published to actually address this question. And just to quote few, this is an article which essentially takes data from the German registry of glaucoma patients, and it has close to 20,000 odd glaucoma patients, and they found that almost 50%, 52.6% had concomitant diagnosis of dry eye. And when they did a subgroup analysis, they found that almost 60% of pseudoexfoliation patients had dry eye. They didn't give the reason, and most of these patients were on monotherapy. Across the globe, many studies have been done on cases. There is a case control studies on with glaucoma group and control group, and majority of them have shown that glaucoma group has prevalence from 40 to 70%, showing dry eye, versus control group showing negligible incidence. So why is this glaucoma having higher risk of dry eye? So we all know glaucoma being a chronic condition, you have to treat them for years together. And most of these patients beyond 2 years would need at least two or three medications to control their IOP. And you're, on the top of it, you're using these preservative containing medications which will have its own effect. So when we talk about ocular surface changes, essentially we are looking at two things, a direct impact of the drug as well as indirect impact that comes to the preservative. When we look at the direct impact, there are studies now which have clearly shown that, for example, there is a prostaglandin analog. It has shown to have higher prevalence of obstructive meibomian gland dysfunction. Beta blocker, because of its action on beta receptors, actually reduce the basal tear turnover rate. Also, it can reduce corneal sensations and bring about inflammatory changes in conjunctiva. But it's the indirect effect which is more important, which is a result of preservative. Most precisely, benzalkonium chloride, we know it is the most commonly used preservative with different concentrations available, and it's a very effective preservative. That's the reason why it is being used so commonly. But it has its own side effects. It causes reduction in the goblet cell density. It has effect on the corneal epithelium. It leads to loss of microvilli at the epithelial cell edges, and it actually accelerates desquamation. It causes cell wrinkling. It causes increase in inflammation. You know, inflammatory markers like MMP levels are increased, and this is what leads to dry eye. Then there is something called as a polyquad, which is also seen in some of the glaucoma medications, and it causes epithelial damage and conjunctival reduction in the conjunctival goblet cells. So then there is a concept of dose-dependent toxicity. So what is the upper limit that one can go for when you are addressing dry eye? So there is a study which has actually addressed this. So it says that the stronger predictors for OSD is if you are using more than 4 drops or 2 topical glaucoma medications is what is the upper limit for batch usage. and we really don't follow this. A lot of times it goes beyond that. Then there is a concentration, the concept of concentration dependent toxicity. As I was talking to you about, you have variable concentration of BAC. So if you have higher the concentration of BAC, there is a more chance of toxicity. So across the different anti-glaucoma medication, you can see the difference in the BAC concentration. You can see the commonly used medications actually have higher BAC concentration. This is important when you're dealing with the patient who has dry eye or who develops dry eye, because that's the patient whom you would want to put him on a lower concentration BAC values. So this chart is very important as far as the PAC. Now, how do you know where, how do you look for which medication has lesser BAC concentration? So this simple website, actually you can go through this website and it gives you a photo with the content there. You can easily pick up content from there and use it for your patient's thing. Now, why does the dry eye get missed in glaucoma? So the simple reason is we don't specifically look for it because we don't give so much of importance to it. And most of our patients really don't complain about it. Even if they complain, the complaints are so non-specific that you don't get a corresponding sign to it. So we actually label it as a psychological issue. So there is a big symptom sign mismatch when you talk about glaucoma and dry eye. On the top of it, there are wide range of clinical manifestations like simple hyperemia, what you can see here, to extensive corneal involvement in the form of corneal SPKs, or sometimes you can always have masquerades like corneal keratoconjunctivitis in this case which was published, or sometimes even like a picture like pseudopemphigoid. So you have such a wide variety of symptoms that you don't attribute it to dry eye. So what I will suggest is that whenever you deal with a patient who comes to you, you divide into three categories. One is a normal patient, second is a pre-existing dry eye, and second is a patient who is on treatment and develops surface issues. So how do you approach these patients? So first thing you would do is basically try to find out certain risk factors which will actually give pointers towards development of dry eye. So you look for old age, postmenopausal women, patients who have very high screen time, patients who have autoimmune conditions like rheumatoid arthritis, they are on systemic medications, they have stress. So these are all patients who will have some or the other, has some possibility that they will eventually develop dry eye. These are simple questionnaires which are available on web. The most common is OSDI questionnaire and DEQ questionnaires. These are available. You can actually ask the patient to fill up. This will give you an idea as to how much is the severity of the patient's complaints. This severity will actually help you to correlate the severity of dry eye. And simple clinical evaluation, really dry eye assessment doesn't need too much of skill. It's a very simple clinical assessment right from lid margin to conjunctiva, tear meniscus, tear debris, T-BERT and Schirmer's test. These are all simple evaluation tools that you can use. Simple compressing the lid margin will tell you what is the quality of meibom that the patient has. If the clear meibom, that means we are not dealing with the meibom gland dysfunction. If you have a cloudy meibom or insipidated meibom is where we are looking at meibom gland dysfunction. Corneal staining pattern, it's a very good idea to document how the staining pattern is, because you can use this scale called as Oxford scale, and actually you can document it in your file, because this will help you when you follow up these patients and understand whether it is improving or not improving. So see the highest grade, almost more than 50% of the cornea is involved by the stain, and believe me, if you start looking for it, you will get it. We don't look at this stain pattern that we actually miss this quite often. In subtle cases, if you can see this, see the right eye and see the left eye. What do we see in the left eye? You can see a ring there. So this ring is essentially nothing but a 80 head imprint. Now, why this should happen in one eye, it's not happening in the other eye, because that eye has been on medication for the last 8 years, which actually tells me that there are certain surface changes that are already happening in that eye. So these are subtle signs which are at you. You should not miss it. So if it's a normal patient, just start with a single agent, a minimal possible dose. Routine lubrication is absolutely not indicated. But if the patient has a pre-existing dry eye, follow the DEWS2 recommendation, which is available online. It's very simple to understand. It's a stepladder approach. I will not be going into details of it, but it's a very nicely written recommendation. Just follow that. If the patient is on pre-existing dry eye, as we discussed, you have to reduce the BAC concentration or you need to shift the patient to a BAC-free. A simple example is Lumigan 0.01% has a BAC of 0.02%. You can just make it 0.03 and the BAC concentration comes down significantly. Or you just shift to a BAC-free medication. Now have a look at this right eye and left eye. The left eye looks little better than the right eye. Why? See, the left eye is on only one single medication. The right eye is on two medications. Essentially three doses, Timolol 2 times, Bimet 1 time versus Bimet 1 time. But what is happening is there is a 3-time greater exposure to back in the right eye, and see the level of damage that is there. This is my own patient. So what you should do in this scenario is just shift to a combination therapy, bring down that number of exposure to back from 3 to 1. And wherever possible, use preservative-free medication. Now we have these two medications which are available as preservative-free. Comode system is there, or a single unit dosage system is available with these two molecules. And lubricants, I'll not go into details, but you should be aware of the 4 classes of lubricants that are available, their thing. But more important is it should be applied as frequently as possible. And for certain specific lubricants, for example, one of the most commonly used lubricant is Cysteine Ultra. We should be aware of it, that it has something called as HP guar, which is a pH sensitive molecule. It will not work if the pH is less than 7.5. Some of our glaucoma medications bring pH below 6. So if you are combining this treatment with say that lubricant, the efficacy of that lubricant will not be very good. So this is something that you need to be aware. Preservatives are also present in lubricants. Always go for oxidative type of preservative, which vanishes off. Preservative free lubricants, only one preservative free lubricant is available in India, which is made in India. The others are from outside, which have been now not been used in India. But if you still want to procure it, it's available on commercial websites like Amazon. But see the cost. It's almost 2,400 rupees for a 30-day course of UNIMS. Compare this to our Indian one, it's just 160 for 30 UNIMS. So the cost factor is a huge factor when you're looking at preservative-free medication. But finally, we are definitely seeing that ocular surface has got its due recognition in this European Glaucoma Society guidelines in 2017. They have included ocular surface as an important consideration when you start the patient on treatment. That means they recommend you to see the ocular surface, and if the patient has significant dry eye, they do insist to start preservative-free medication. So to just sum up, dry eye and glaucoma are definitely closely related. Actively look for dry eye before starting any form of treatment. Keep the medication to the minimum to mitigate cumulative drug dose toxicity. Lubricants, preferably preservative-free, should be used in the cases where it is required, and modify treatment based on ocular surface and patient symptoms. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Sagartha, for that excellent talk. A lot of important issues came up in that talk. Does anybody have any questions? I think Manish has a question.
Please.
I just wanted to ask a very simple, practical question. That is, when a patient comes to you with glaucoma, when you follow, and if the patient doesn't complain of dry eye, do again you go for a dry eye workup and start treatment before the patient becomes symptomatic? Do you give any prophylactic therapy?
No.
Or how do you start treatment?
So that's what I was just saying. Just simple clinical evaluation on slit lamp will give you an idea whether the patient is going to develop a dry eye or is having a mild dry eye. Before just starting the treatment, look at the lid, which you can see from the thing. Just compress the lid margin. See that meibomian gland secretion. Very, very important. Very, very important. Routine duplication in a normal person who has a good tear meniscus height, no staining pattern on the cornea, and has no symptoms. The question is, it's difficult to use in a clinical, in our busy practice setting, but tear meniscus size, tear debris, corneal staining pattern will give you an idea whether this patient is having dry eye or is going to likely to develop dry eye. So the routine lubrication definitely not necessary. But the point that I want to highlight is that start with minimum possible dosage, because in the long run, definitely what started with zero, over a period of time, 50 to 70% of these patients will develop surface issues. There's no doubt about it.
So you mean, say, starting any patient on any anti-glaucoma medication, you must do a rosin stain?
Absolutely. Because you are anyway doing it for your IOP measurement. So before you put that 80 head, just see the staining pattern of the cornea.
That's a good take home.
Yeah, I have a question for Dr. Siraj. What has been your experience with this preservative-free anti-glaucoma medication, and what are the cases you use them?
We don't have many preservative-free in our, because it's given by the government. So we don't have many preservative-free with us. So I look for it when I suspect the patients have got dryness. Either I put them on a gel at night if they're on timo, if they're on travoprost, for example. I tell them to have the travoprost at 8 p.m. and then put the gel at night before they go to bed. So exactly the gel keeps working through the night. That's what we do. Or we give preservative-free eye drops, not for glaucoma, but artificial tears.
No brains.
So I've got one last question.
Yeah.
None of the brands, except for Saflutan, which has just come, are preservative-free.
Yeah.
So if a patient with glaucoma has dry eye, would you sacrifice a brand for a generic which is preservative-free? Would you do that?
See, what you are saying is absolutely right. There is no. Now again, this is like a trial error method. You have to go in for a molecule which is less toxic to the patient, and at times you have to even give him a drug holiday. So that happens intermittently with few of my patients who have severe surface issues. What I do when they land up into an acute phase, I just stop all the medications and then again start from single dose and then keep going forward. But preservative free medications will come. So already this one has come, so you'll have more in the pipeline.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much, Sagata. Thank you. Yeah, please, ma'am.
That is the biggest problem with dry eye. Most of the patients are asymptomatic with severe dry eye as well. So you don't really depend on patient symptoms. At the most, you can use a questionnaire to elicit where they are facing the problem.
So if the patient is not symptomatic, even if you find that,
yeah, absolutely.
So better you should do something.
Absolutely.
Without making him concerned that this is another treatment, another issue, whatever.
Absolutely.